No more tears.
Amen.
Part 2. No more tears, part 2. We had part 1 some time ago, 2 days ago. Yesterday was our worship session, but today we'll be having part 2. And I told God that we will see how another part after this. In the book of Mark chapter 9, 14 to 27, but we can just stop at 14 to 17 today, so that we just deal with something that we want to deal with in that portion of the scripture. And when he came to his disciples, he saw a great multitude about them, and the scribes questioning with them. And straightway, all the people, when they beheld him, were greatly amazed, and running to him, saluted him. And he asked the scribes, what question ye with them? And one of the multitude answered and said, Master, I have brought unto thee my son, which had a dumb spirit. We are going to be talking today. Well, before today, the first part of this maybe short series that we are saying no more tears, we said in that first part that living this life, a joyful person all the time, is a tough business, and it's not so easy. Because sometimes sad things will happen to good people, no matter how righteous you are, no matter how good you are, no matter how talented you are, no matter how nice you are, whatever thing that you may want to call yourself, that is actually good. That bad things sometimes will happen, sad things will happen. So living a joyful life all the time, or being in that joyful state all the time, is hard. It is tough. But if you have to, which is good to, you need to make conscious decision to live a joyful life. We said that even Jesus Christ, the Bible said that he went about doing good. But when he got to a particular time, they were crying, crucifying. They gave them option. They chose him to be crucified. That is the kind of life that we live in. So we said that we have to make conscious decision to live a joyful life in this life. And you make that conscious decision knowing that in this life there will be mountaintop experience and valley experience. In the portion that we read, Jesus, Peter, James and John, they went up the mountain. And when they got there, the experience was so nice. In fact, Jesus Christ transfigured before them. And Peter suggested, let us stay here. I think that should be in Mark chapter 9, verse 5 or so. Mark chapter 9, verse 5. He said, let us stay here. He said, it is good for us to remain here. Everybody desires to have that experience of joy every time. Because mountain can be referred to the time that things are happening to you. Very good. You are on the top. And Peter answered and said to Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here. And let us make 3 tabernacles, one for thee, and one for Moses, and one for Elijah. Everybody desires to be there. But verse 9, Mark 9:9, they came down. Maybe Jesus Christ, maybe it was the devil that was with them that they came down. No, Jesus Christ was still there, and they still came down. Reality of life. And as they came down from the mountain, meaning that sometimes, even as a nice person, you experience the valley. And we said that before man was even created, God had already created light to have day and night, darkness and light. Genesis 1:5, the Bible said that he made dots, and that is a typical day. A typical day is made of day and night, darkness and light. You cannot be so good that you say, I want to be experiencing mountaintop experience every time or light every time. No, that is living in a fool's paradise. But one thing that the successful people or the people that will keep good attitude all the time know is that no matter how thick the darkness may be in the night, money will come. But that though weeping may endure for a night, in Psalm 30 verse 5, money will come. And when money comes, it always comes with joy. So it helps them to go through the night with the expectation that after this time, I'm going to get to the point of my joy. And that keeps them. And they know that it will eventually come. And we said something, another point that we gave in the first part of this series, is that Jesus Christ, immediately he came down from the mountain, they rushed to him. Another point that I even forgot to give them is that immediately they came down from the mountain, a problem was waiting for him. That is the irony of life. And we said that this life is full of irony. How night is so close to the morning? Because night was just some hours away, or maybe some minutes away, and morning has not already come. Very shortly now, I don't need to be a prophet. Even somebody said, I cancel that prophecy, it will come, night will come. And that is our life. I think that when I say that our joy is so interwoven with sorrow at times, pain and pleasure interwoven together. And we give different instances that how the pleasure of sexual relationship between a man and a woman could be so close to the pain of carrying the pregnancy, of morning sickness, of labor. And that pain is also close to the joy of carrying the baby and celebration, people saying congratulations. And now that joy is also close to the pain of having to wake up in the night, nurse the baby, trying to do everything that could even stress you. And now that pain is close to the joy of seeing the baby for the first time walking and you are rejoicing. And how that joy is also close to the pain of there are issues in the school. You are going to the hospital. You are carrying the baby. That in this life, pain and joy, when you understand that when you are going to painful period, don't know that joy will come. That how the joy of getting an admission is so close to the pain of having to burn the midnight candle and study. And how that pain is close to the day of graduation, the joy of celebration. How that joy is also close to trying to look for a job and is now getting frustrating with person. And how the joy of getting the job is not so close to the pain of having to settle the challenges of the job. And on, life is like that. But Jesus Christ being the light, immediately he came down from the mountain, they rushed to him. And we said that we should be light. He even said that in the book of Matthew chapter 5:14, that we are the light of the world. He, when he was in this world, in John chapter 9 verse 5, he said that I am the light of the world, as long as I am in this world. But now when he was going, he said that you too are the light of the world. And we said something about light. Light is attractive. Whenever you see light, you see people want to gather. Whenever there is no light in the night, whenever you see light in the house, the tendency is that people around that place, maybe they are watching TV or they are doing one discussion. Whenever you see any room that light has been put up, the tendency is that nobody is there. That is how it is. That we should be light. That a church that is light will not be begging people for members. It will come. A person that is light will not be begging people to come and see this. Or a pastor that is light, or a believer that is light, will never beg anyone. They will always come. Be light that God has made you to be. and God will remove every tear from you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Today we are going to be talking about deliverance from the dumb spirit briefly. The Bible says that immediately Jesus Christ came down from that mountain, the multitude rushed to him, and one of them said that he had brought his son to the disciples, but they could not do anything concerning his son. What happened to the son? He said that his son had a dumb spirit. Deliverance from the dumb spirit. One thing about being dumb is that you are speechless. You cannot speak. You cannot express yourself. You cannot make utterance. Whatever the devil may be doing to you, ensure that he does not get you to the point of being dumb to talk to God. Whatever. Anything can happen to anybody at any time, but ensure you never allow the devil to get you to the point that you cannot talk to God. Prayerlessness is a manifestation of the spirit of dumbness. Many people don't, they are looking at the scripture, this person has a dumb spirit. But as long as you are prayerless, that spirit is operating in the person's life. You don't, things are happening in the person's life, but to not open your mouth to talk to God, the devil has. Thank God, a brother came to us, or referred to us yesterday. And then, Pastor, I used to be very prayerful, but now, I don't know, I feel weak. I said, don't worry. God will reignite you, and the fire of wanting to pray will come upon you, that we will anoint you and will decree into your life. Every spirit of prayerlessness that could have been affecting you, let it go from you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Because if a person is blind, but you can still talk, that can be resolved. Blind Bartimaeus, in the book of Mark chapter 10, 46 to 52, Mark 10, 46 to 52, he could not see, he heard that Jesus Christ was passing by, and he used his tongue, his mouth. He said, Jesus of Nazareth, have mercy on me. Some people were even telling him to keep short. But the Bible says that he shouted them all, and Jesus Christ stood still and settled him. That issue was resolved in his life. If you have been afflicted or you have sickness in any part of your body, as long as your tongue has not been padlocked, your mouth has not been padlocked, your tongue has not twisted, then solution can come. In the book of Luke chapter 17, 11 to 14, Luke 17, 11 to 14, 10 lepers, they were stricken with leprosy. And they had the mouth, they called on Jesus Christ, Son of David, have mercy on us. And through their mouths, they got their healing. In the book of James chapter 5, 13 to 15, James chapter 5, 13 to 15, they said, is any afflicted among you? What did they tell the person to do? Let him pray. Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. If any Mary, let him sing psalm. If any sick among you, let them call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. 15. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he has committed sins, they shall be forgiven. It is the miracle is in your mouth. Let me just summarize it. The miracle is in your mouth. In the book of Numbers chapter 14, 28, Numbers 14, 28, it says that whatever they will speak in my ear, what did God say he will do? He will do it for them. Don't get to the point that you are so overwhelmed with your challenges that you will not open your mouth. That is the dumb spirit. Isn't that this person? He has been afflicted with the dumb spirit. You need to be delivered from the dumb spirit. Don't get so overwhelmed. Is God hearing me? Who told you that God is doing? You don't have to feel that God is hearing or not hearing. Sometimes truly, it appears as if God is not hearing. But whether you feel it or you don't feel it, God hears. In the book of Psalm 94, verse 9, Psalm 94, verse 9, he that created ears, he that has fashioned the ears, will he know what?
Yes.
He know ye. He that planted the ears, shall he not? You know, there's some scripture that once you just have them, I may feel as if they don't hear me because of it, but I know that he hears. So let me talk. But concerning this thing, please raise up help for me. Go to that place on my behalf. As you are saying it, he's hearing. You don't have to feel that he hears or he's not hearing. Your mouth, ensure that you don't keep your mouth shut. As long as you don't keep your mouth shut, God will always move on your behalf. That was what David actually used to bring down Goliath in the book of 1 Samuel chapter 17. 1 Samuel 17, I think 46 to about 50. He was telling the Goliath that he will cut off his neck, his head from him without a sword. But it actually happened like that. Your mouth is so powerful that whatever has gone wrong in your life, with your mouth you can turn it to become right again. That's what happened to Jabez. Jabez is the book of 1 Chronicles chapter 4, 9 and 10. 1 Chronicles chapter 4, 9 and 10. Are you going through sorrowful situation? Just like Jabez. With your mouth, the Bible says that he called on the Lord and God granted him all that he had requested. Pray to God with your mouth. Then number two, confess positively with your mouth in line with what you are asking God for. Don't be praying one thing and you are confessing another thing. You are not canceling what you have prayed with your confession. In the book of Joel chapter 3 verse 10, Joel chapter 3 verse 10, says that let the weak say what?
I am strong.
Confess what you are expecting, not what you are experiencing. Can you rise to our feet and say, Father,
Father,
every dumb spirit that could have beseeched me, deliver me from me now, in the name of Jesus. Deliver me from every dumb spirit. Feeling that makes me to be weak at night when I want to pray. I will not feel like, oh, I cannot pray. It's a dumb spirit. Deliver me from it. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Say, Father, help me to always be conscious.
Help me to always be conscious
of talking to you, concerning every issue in my life. In the name of Jesus, help me be conscious. Let me always not forget. Let me not overbother to the point that I'll not forget that I have to even tell God about how I'm feeling. To help me. Help me. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Now let Father Calais and say,
Father,
I decree
by
your power
that
every problem, every challenge that is present in my life disappear. Make them disappear. Let every problem, any challenge, anything that has brought evidence to me, depression to me, by the power of the Almighty God, disappear. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Say, Father, raise up help for me all over the world. Let now in the name of Jesus, let help be raised for me all over the world. Let help be raised for me. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Jesus Christ was admonishing the disciples. He said that if you say unto this mountain, without move and cast, without doubting your heart, it shall be done. Open your mouth and pray and say, Father. Every mountain that is blocking my way from making progress in any area of my life, be moved and cast into the sea of forgetfulness. Be moved. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Father, thank you because you have said you will wipe away all tears from your eyes. Let there be no more tears.
Amen.
In our lives.
Amen.
In every area of our lives.
Amen.
In our family.
Amen.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you,
in Jesus' mighty name, we are praying.
Amen. Amen.